should be able to happen by September.
And just an aside, you may have noticed in some of the notes from the meetings, we're also looking at updating our website with regard to board members, so that we may, we're talking about possibly putting pictures, having individual bios for each one of the board members so that we are identified to the public. We're also going to update all of our access cards, so that we look like who we are. And I think that even Mr. Walsh doesn't even have one that works. So we're going to make sure that across the board, we all are up to date on those things. So we're working on a lot of different things.
Thank you. Mr. Walsh is not here for the delegate report, so we will move to open to the public. If you want to speak, just come to the mic.
Hi, thanks for the microphone. Amy Syracuse, 519 High Street. I wanted to ask a question during the HIP presentation, and I was deferred, so I'm going to start by asking that question. Mr. Mastretta, I'm going to, I guess, address you. It has to do with parents.
Mrs. Syracuse, you have to address the board, and then we can ask him to respond to you. No, just ask us. Go ahead.
Well, I'd like to know what's being done in the way of parent education. I think the nature of HIP incidents today is that an awful lot of things happen outside of the classroom. Sometimes it's lunch or recess. Sometimes it's online at home. And I think that a very important aspect of any bullying, anti-bullying campaign is making sure parents are trained in what's HIP and what's maybe just good old-fashioned conflicts between kids, and then also in the ability to report it. I've looked around at a lot of other school districts' websites. Paramus, for example, posts the state-mandated timeline in terms of reporting procedures, what needs to be done when, definitions of what's HIP and what's not. And I think, unless I'm wrong, that component is missing here. And it's something I think it's essential. Not only could it cut down on investigations that aren't actually HIP, which cost time and resources and money, but hopefully it could help maybe even eliminate some of the incidents. So that's my first question, is what's being done?
Yes, I'd be happy to respond to that. We have spoken about that at our administrative meeting at the end of this past school year, and we spoke about both updating and increasing the amount of information on our website. And in addition, we're also looking at putting together some kind of parent workshop activity. We had hoped we could do it at the end of this past year, but we wanted to do it in partnership with River Edge, and they, you know, our times just didn't mesh. So we're looking at something in this coming fall for parents. So those are two things that we've already spoken about. And there is also on our website a place to where you can send messages or make suggestions. If there's other things that you would like to see that you think we're missing, by all means, let us know. And we'll certainly put out anything that we possibly can.
Well, you know I'm very shy about those things. My second question had to do with your correction, Dorothy. I think the number two item had to do with the board office salaries. And I have some confusion about that because you spoke about the five-borough curriculum position, which I know has been eliminated, but my understanding is that that was an administrative position, not a board and superintendent's office position. And so I'm confused as to why it's been lumped in there.
So it was an administrative position that we shared with Riverbridge, and we with the salary in half, and it is still an administrative position.
Okay, so why would that offset? It seems like you ran through it so quickly, and I know you have a lot of points to cover, but my confusion stems from the fact that you seem to use it to kind of offset the increase in the board positions, and I just want to make sure that everything was factually correct.
It's factually correct. We had three positions that we replaced. Two of them were by borough. We split the salaries with River Edge.
I'm just saying, I think it's an apples to oranges scenario if it's an administrative position, because what my post online, which you seem to be addressing, was purely addressing the board and superintendent support positions. And I don't see what the bi-borough position would really have to do with any of it.
I'm not following you.
Maybe send me your written response and I can review it. I'd just like to check those numbers because I had some concerns and I just want to make sure that everything was presented correctly.
Okay, because I think what you're saying is maybe the part-time secretary who is now in the superintendent's office because she's not
That's a new position.
Right, but she's replacing the old by borough position. So it's still a person that we needed, but we can't call them by borough. We can't call it by borough. It just has to be, it had to be renamed.
I see that you're offsetting the expenditure, but I'm just saying you're also creating new positions.
We're renaming a position. We're renaming the job. It's not a new position. We're renaming the person that...
Part-time job is not a new position.
We're renaming it. No, it's not new. There was a part-time secretary that we shared with River.
But that was an administrative position.
No, secretarial is not administrative.
You just said the by-borough was
administrative. It was by-borough. The by-borough curriculum person was administrative. The secretarial is just by-borough, they're not administrative. So that function is still necessary. So those two positions were renamed. So that's why I took them as a group, because there was three positions and there's still three positions. Two of them had to be renamed.
Okay, so number three, I just wasn't clear on the timeline for scope. You said that the scope results would be made public and they would be made public by September?
Yes.
Okay, and they would be made public in the context of this meeting or you're considering a special event?
No, I was going to simply take an opportunity at our meeting in September to share more of this information and we'll post it within the next week.
And will we view the full report or just excerpts?
Sure.
Okay. Number four, I had a question about the personnel. Specifically, I was looking at the maternity leave replacement for the LLD classroom, and I noticed that it's a per diem salary.
Can you say what number page you're on and what?
I'm on page of the personnel addendum. It's page two.
Okay, which...
Are you with me?
Page two, which person?
Alexis
Delmonica.
Okay. Right. So I noticed this is a per diem, and I just, I have experience with this classroom. It serves a very specialized role within the school, and I just want to know what the impact of having a per diem salary is on recruiting qualified candidates.
So the reason why we had to publish it that way is because the state guideline has a time element involved before we can switch the individual from per diem to salary. And there is a question mark as to the length of time for this leave. So in order to get our candidate approved, we started by publishing the per diem rate as soon as we know the length of the leave, and if we can get to the state cutoff, we can switch that person over to a salary. So we're simply following the state guidelines for how to handle that.
Okay, and is that the standard practice throughout the school for any leave replacement?
Yes. And I can also assure you that we had very, very high quality, outstanding candidates who applied, and out of that pool, I think we made a really great choice. So I think we have a really high quality person we're going to put in a classroom that we recognize needs a good high quality teacher.
Were you able to get all the qualifications that you asked for?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so.
Okay. And my last question is really procedural about the personnel addendum. I checked online earlier today in search of that personnel addendum because I was interested in this information. I noticed when the tentative agenda was posted that it was posted without this addendum. I actually called Eileen in the board office and asked at what point it would be posted because I think it's important that people have the full information. Sometimes that impacts whether someone wants to attend a meeting or not, and they need to know in advance whether what they're interested in is going to be discussed. And Eileen told me, no problem, it's going to be posted by close of business. So what time was closed business? 3:30. So I expected that that would transpire and it did not. And as of when I left to come to this meeting, it still hadn't been posted. And I just want to make sure that it's going to be posted at some point and part of the full public record. Obviously, you're going to be converting from a tentative to a confirmed agenda. And I just want to make sure that information will be there and accessible to everyone.
Of course. And Mrs. Gallagher, when she told you that, was correct. I was the one who asked her to hold because I knew that we were going to make a couple of significant changes at the last minute because we had a personnel committee meeting scheduled for 6 o'clock. So I asked her to hold it temporarily, knowing that I would have it, some changes to be published in time for this meeting. So our typical norm is going to be to have it posted on the same business day. We'll get it out as quickly as we know we can. And then once the board has approved it, then it will be posted first thing the following morning. So by 9 o'clock tomorrow, it will be on our website.
Okay, and in the event that it happens in the future, might it be possible to post a tentative addendum and to add in the uncertainties later?
Sure, that's possible. Kind of depends on what changes we have to make, but where possible, absolutely.
Okay, great, thank you.
Any other questions?
Live at 630 Schaefer Avenue.
You have to bring that down, she's taller than you.
Anyway, my question is, are there any plans in removing and replacing the dead trees by the property?
Oh my goodness, Greg should be here tonight. This is his topic.
It's my topic. You know, this is my third job. I work at Isley's, and I've been looking at those dead trees. 4 years.
Yes. As a matter of fact, my head of building and grounds and I spoke about this just a day or two ago, and I asked him to get some quotes to put new trees. I also asked him to pull out the dead ones. So we are working on that, and we do recognize that it needs improvement, and we're going to try to do that as quickly as we can. The only reason why we held off was because my unfortunate experience with gardening has been that I've never had good success planting things in the summer and they die on me. So all the gardening people tell me to plant trees closer to the fall. So that's why we waited.
Okay, but this has been years.
But he's just got here. He's working on it.
But wait a minute. Isley's, we're planting all summer. We're sending crews out. So just want you to know if you can plant.
Maybe you could have an art project that makes statues for there.
No, let's just pull it. They're all good.
Thank you so much.
I think you're fine. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
It takes a long time.
Take your time.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
No? Do you want to? I guess you know I don't question.
Since you already do, so.
Since you asked.
Until it's finalized, I would wait. You know, we appreciate you coming, but until we finalize it and have that person in place, I would guess we're not sure until it happens.
We're hoping next meeting, yes. But we're not promising.
Okay.
We're hoping, though, strongly.
I appreciate the microphones. I really, really, truly do. And
I'm still thinking about the legal bills, what I want to do. I appreciate the, I guess the, sorry, what's the word? Not count.